98A, Dory, etc. But there are a large number of offshoots. And the team of Beyond Law, CLC and ULS thought that let's have a person who will give us a, though we will call it a bird eye view, but we are quite sacrosanct, that the doubts which are in the mind of anybody will be dispelled today. Welcome you, sir, on behalf of Beyond Law CLC and ULS Punjab University, Chandigarh. Sir.
Very good evening to all viewers. This is an interactive session organized by Mr. Chatra through Aegis of CLC. It is always a privilege to share views, especially on a question of marriage, which has changed paradigm after 85, to be precise, after 25th of December 1983, when the legislature brought Section 306 in addition to Section 113A with the presumption in Section 498A. The courts, which were earlier not engaged with the matrimonial litigation, were suddenly flooded with the litigation. Before that, we come to the law relating to marriages. No law can be applied in abstract. A law has philosophical moorings. It is to the ground realities of a country or a nation. It has a socio-economic value, and law is to be applied in that context. So far, philosophical moorings are concerned, it is said as first time Sigmund Freud came with psychoanalysis. He said there is a conscious mind, there is a subconscious mind, and there is an unconscious mind. It is an unconscious mind which determines the behavior of a human being. Therefore, so far marriages are concerned, one is subject to change, change is subject to pain. He said that it is due to Oedipus complex or in a childhood, one acquires certain kind of sexual preferences, and for which suddenly two human beings become compatible, two human beings can't stand each other. You will find that all human beings are good. It is in which, how they are placed, it's their behavior determines. So the Freud said that it's a sexual preferences. At the same time, came a Jung, he with a different theory. He said it's an analytical psychology. He said it is nothing, it is maladjustments. It is maladjustments which determine our behavior. And the third philosopher who came is Adler with the individual psychology. He said, no, neither is a sexual preferences, nor it is maladjustments. In fact, it is an ego clash which determines our compatibility or incompatibility. In every relationship, there is a one dominant relationship and one is a subordinate to that relationship. This is a psychological analysis of a subconscious mind which determine behavior of two human beings, one man and another woman, which lead to success of a marriage. Before that, I must quote two things. It is said, there is an anonymous saying that a husband and wife may disagree on many things, but they must absolutely agree on this to never ever give up. So it is determination to continue in the institution of marriage, which leads to the success of marriage. Another philosopher, Dave Murin, said, a great marriage is not when the perfect couple comes together, it is when an imperfect couple learns to enjoy their differences. So besides our differences, we even start understanding the person, live with our imperfections, then the success of marriage came. Contrary to this, there is a Hindu belief that marriage is made in heaven, it is predetermined, this is Sanyog, even when it takes birth, to whom you will be married, it is there, marriage is a sacred institution. We give sapatpati, gives vows to take care, the seven promises are exchanged, and the marriage, in fact, is a sacred institution alien to marriages in other religions, which determine it as a social contract. So far, over law is concerned, over social values concerned, the relationship of husband and wife, institutional marriage is well recognized in law. Section 122 of the Indian Evidence Act recognizes privilege between husband and wife. It says when husband and wife step into witness box, they can claim a privilege that any communication made with husband and wife, they cannot disclose, and they can take a communication as a lawyer-client relationship. One can claim a privilege. So while deposing as a witness, husband and wife, there is a privilege available. Similarly, Section 27 of the Indian Penal Code says that the wife, that if a wife is in possession of the property, it will be understood that husband is in possession of the property. So to this extent, law recognizes relationship of two human beings, man and a woman, as a husband and wife. So for Section 122 and Section 127 of the Indian Penal Code is concerned. In 1985, this Indian Penal Code was made in 1860. Offenses relating to marriage are covered under Chapter 20 of the Indian Penal Code. So far, the lawmakers, Indian Penal Code was concerned, the marriage was an entirely private affair where the state will not intrude, will not cause an interference. All offenses under Chapter 20, starting from Section 493 to 498, they were non-cognizable offenses. Therefore, the police cannot register a case. One has to file a complaint to prosecute another person. Similarly, it is not that anybody can lodge the complaint. A right was only given to institute prosecution only to the aggrieved person. Who is an aggrieved person? A definition has been given under Section 198. A wife is a lunatic, idiot, or less than 18 years of age. On his behalf, father, mother, they can file a complaint. Similarly, if the man, husband is in the army, and on his behalf with the leave of court, somebody can file a complaint. So much so, you will see that in offense of bigamy, it is only an aggrieved wife, which is a first wife or a second wife, who can file a complaint. Nobody else can find. You will find number of film stars who perform second marriage. They are living well, even if they have not converted, because there is no aggrieved party. A third person cannot launch a complaint. Therefore, till 1980, it remained an entirely private affair between two citizens, and state had no concern with them until parties to the marriage opted to bring their dispute to the court of law. Therefore, we must understand that till police, state was kept out of the marriage, our litigation was very less. So what are the offenses which are given in Chapter 20? Let's have a broad, quick view. Section 493 and Section 496. And 494, they are regarding the sham marriages, marriages which are due to the deceit or by fraudulent. One is made to believe that that a woman is a wife of a person, and he have a sexual intercourse in the context of the marriage, which is a sham marriage. Then these offenses are there. They are also to be at the instance of a grieved wife. Section 494 and 495 are offenses of bigamy, where only an aggrieved wife could launch the proceedings, or an aggrieved husband from whom the fact of marriage is concealed can institute the proceedings. Section 497 is offense regarding the adultery, which has been recently made in a judgment by the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court in Joseph Schein, 2019, Volume 3, SEC, page 39, as held to be ultra vires, saying that it brings discrimination between two genders, and therefore the offense of adultery cannot remain on a statute book. It is with the concept that woman is neither a chattel, woman is neither a property of a man. She is an individual, she has her own rights. Therefore, 497 and so far Section 198 of CRPC which gives device a way to launch prosecution have been set aside by a 5-judge bench, all concurring to an extent that offense of Section 497 has outlived, and in the present era, in the modern era, this offense under Section 497 cannot remain on a statute book. So the offense of adultery is no longer on a statute book. Then we have criminal elopement, which comes under Section 198. So far, this is Chapter 20 was concerned. I said till 1982, no policeman could barge into a family affairs or a relationship of husband and wife until they wanted to initiate the proceedings. First came issue before the Punjab and the High Court, whether gifts given to the wife at the time of marriage, they constitute istri dhan of a woman, and if the same is not returned by the husband, or they are entrusted to the family members of the husband and they are retained and they are not accounted for, whether offense under Section 406 IPC will be made out or not. First in lead came a full bench judgment on Punjab and Haryana High Court in Vinod Kumar Sethi versus State of Punjab, AR 1982, Punjab and Haryana, page 372. They recognized gifts given to the wife at the time of marriage by husband, father-in-law, mother-in-law, relations of the husband, relations of the wife, dowry articles as istri dhan, but they said that there is a joint possession of husband and wife relying upon the Partnership Act, saying that if the two partners they hold joint property, no offense of misappropriation is made out and Section 406 is not made out. The matter went to the Supreme Court. Full bench of Punjab and Haryana High Court was set aside in a judgment, and Pratibha Rani versus Suraj Kumar, 1985, volume 2, SEC, page 372, they relied upon the observations of Sir Garud Das Banerjee in Hindu law and marriage. They quoted Katyayan and said, neither the husband, nor the son, nor the father, nor the brother has the power to alienate the legal property of a woman. And if any of them shall consume such property against her consent, he shall be compelled to pay its value with interest to her and shall also pay fine to the king. Whatever she has put amicably into the hands of the husband, afflicted by disease, suffering from distress of society, pressed by creditors, he should repay that by his own free will. Then the line upon Manu, they said, what kind of gifts made before the, at the time of marriage, gifts made at the bridal procession, gifts made in token of law, by in-laws, by father-in-law, mother-in-law, elders of the family of the husband, gifts made by father, gifts made by mother, gifts made by brother and sister, they all constitute istri dhan, and it is not a joint property. It is exclusive property of the wife, and if the same is retained by the husband, he will not account for the same offense under Section 406 is made out. So in 1983, offense of 406 came on a statute where it became a cognizable offense, and five can initiate proceedings by getting a case registered, and first time came the involvement of the woman. Then there was suddenly rise in the suicide. The women were inflicted by cruelty. There was a harassment. There was a maltreatment. And a joint committee of both the houses of the parliament came with the recommendation that the penal law should be brought on a statute book so that the wife, those who commit offense of cruelty to the wife, they are prosecuted. Therefore, on 25th of December 1983, Section 498A came on the statute book as a Chapter 20A of the Indian Penal Code. And similarly, with the Section 306, section 113A was added, and it was said that if the woman commits suicide within 7 years of a marriage, it will be presumed that the husband and wife, that the husband and his relations treated the wife with cruelty, and therefore they will be presumed to be guilty. And that it, that this presumption was to be, the onus was on the family members of the husband to rebut the presumption. Along with that came section 198B, which said that besides wife, who can file a complaint? That is by relations, by marriage, by blood, or by adoption. Therefore, on the behalf of the wife, complaint could be filed by her father, by her mother, by brother and sister of father or mother, and they could launch the proceedings. Then also the section 498A, only a grieved person within the ambit of section 198B could launch the proceedings. Now, let's see what are the offenses of suicide, who have they been dealt by the courts. What is abetment to suicide? One has to take recourse to section 107 of the Indian Penal Code. Clause first of which says that if someone instigate the person to commit offense, to commit suicide, then those can, then that person can be. All right, I can continue. All right. It said the first time came a Division Bench of Punjab and Haryana High Court, Rajkumar versus State of Punjab. They said that instigate means if someone propel, impel, provoke, got somebody to commit suicide, then only an active role of a mission or commission can constitute offense of suicide. Then came a judgment of Gangula Mohan Reddy and Amdul Bal Jhanta. I will just give the citations briefly. Gangula Mohan Reddy versus State of Andhra Pradesh and Amdul Bal Jhanta versus State of West Bengal. They said the orderly discord and petulance in day-to-day life in a, will not constitute offense of abetment to suicide. What is the definition of a cruelty? As subject under section 113A, it is said the definition of cruelty will be same as under section 198 IBC, which we will discuss when we take section 498A for discussion. Number of issues came. Say if a husband is a drunkard, he is alcoholic, and he harassed the wife, whether it will amount to abetment to suicide. Then the judgments came on either side that if a husband takes liquor and his wife restrain him and husband is not accepting the restraint and then wife commits suicide, it will not be abetment to suicide. But if being a husband, being alcoholic, cause harassment, take away the money, give beating to the wife, then it will be a vice which lead to the suicide and the husband can be prosecuted and convicted. Similarly, it came that if husband is having an extra marital relationship, whether the same will constitute abetment to suicide or not. A very good judgment has come by the Supreme Court, which one must read. That is Punakki Mahapatra Rawal versus State of Gujarat, 2013, volume 10, SEC. It is, says alienation of affection. For the first time, it was introduced that if wife feels that he is not given affection by the husband, affection of the husband is towards another woman, that alienation of affection in what circumstances will constitute mental cruelty depending on the evidence. That is a very good judgment which all criminal lawyers or practicing on the criminal side must read. That is 2013, volume 10, SEC, page 488. One judgment on a suicide, which I will strongly recommend, though it has been watered down by the time, is a judgment rendered by the Supreme Court in Sharad Birdi Chand Sarda versus State of Maharashtra, 1984, AR 1642. They have gone into the various law, various books of psychology as to what, how the suicide tendencies are developed, how one becomes a hypersensitive, in which case one will commit suicide. They rely upon the book of Robert J. Christenborn of Death, Society and Human Experiences and others, as into what circumstances one will commit suicide. This will give a perspective, a vision to a criminal lawyer regarding suicide, regarding deaths which is committed by taking poison. The one of the condition prerequisite that the prosecution must explain as though the poison was obtained no longer is accepted by the judicial verdict has been watered down, but at the same time it is a very good judgment which all criminal lawyers or those practice on criminal side, or if you want to have your vision regarding the suicide, this must be read. Therefore, I strongly recommend Sharad Birdi Chand Sarda versus State of Maharashtra, 1984, AR, page 1622. Having said about section 304B, 306, I revert to know section 304B of the Indian Penal Code. This section came on a statute book in 1986, along with section 113B of the Code of Evidence Act, Indian Evidence Act. Section 304B says that if a woman within 7 years of marriage, if death is caused by burns, bodily injury, or it is a death which is otherwise in the normal circumstances, and the death is within 7 years, and it is shown that the soon before the marriage, she was harassed, subjected to cruelty on the account of dowry, it will be a dowry death. Now, lot of issues came. What is a dowry? If husband and wife are living for 4 or 5 years, husband, in order to enhance his business, take financial help or aid from in-laws, or if on the birth of a child in Haryana, you will find number of cases where it is called suchik ceremony is there, when the, if the gifts are not given properly, or if on a, say, account of a birth of a child, gift is not given, whether same will constitute dowry, demand of dowry or not, we must realize that to cover up this, the Dowry Prohibition Act was amended, the definition of the dowry was changed, and it was said, dowry, it was included that any time after marriage. Earlier in the definition of the dowry, it was not any time after the marriage. Once the amendment came, now it was covered up, and the courts came to conclusion by interpretation that even after the marriage, if financial aid is given in relation to the marriage, success of the marriage, it will come within the definition of the dowry, and offense under section 304B will be made out. One of the judgment is Prem Kumar versus State of Rajasthan, 2009, volume 3, SEC, page 726. Then the question came, what is the soon before? Then the court said soon before cannot be put in straight jackets, but suddenly it is not immediate before the death, unnatural death of the wife. Therefore, a three-judge bench to reconcile the differences overruled the various judgments of the Supreme Court and came to conclusion that the exhaustive definition, which is very broad, of dowry will prevail, and soon before is not immediate. It can be, it must have a nexus, and it must be qualified by unity of time, place, and action. And therefore, it will be soon before, will depend upon facts and circumstances of the case. That three-judge judgment, very well written by Justice Rinton Nariman, is a Rajinder Singh versus State of Punjab, 2015, volume 6, SEC, page 477. Now, having covered the broaden the definition of dowry, we must take that even suicide by a right, which also is an unnatural death. And even if a murder, there is no evidence in the house, the offense is committed within four corners of the house. It is by burns, it is by bodily injury, that is also covered under section 304B. Simply because there is not evidence of the murder, but wife has died inside the house, therefore, it offense under section 304B, IPC is made out. Then the question, death questions of the death of a woman came inside the family house, in the matrimonial house, where there is no demand of dowry, there is no credulity, but wife suddenly died or is found dead because of injuries or otherwise in the house of her husband, that is her matrimonial home. Then the courts came to conclusion that presumption under section 106 under section 302 will be implied, and it, since the facts are especially in the knowledge of the husband, he has to explain how a wife died in the four corners of the house, that is a matrimonial home. Therefore, at the house came to conclusion that offense under section 302 IPC is made out. Along with came issue cropped up whether a husband who is charged for offense under section 302 can he be convicted for the offense under section 306 IPC. The first time in the case of Lakwinder Singh, they came that the charges under section 306 and 302 are distinct. They are mutually exclusive. If the prosecution comes with the theory of a suicide, then you can't convict somebody with 302. The prosecution charge sheet has to contain the facts. Prosecution must tell the accused whether he's committed offense of a abetment to suicide or offense of a murder. There came Supreme Court judgments of speaking differently. Somebody said, relying upon a William Saleh, 5-inch constitutional bench. William Saleh was in 19 versus Madhya Pradesh, 1956 Supreme Court, which is a constitutional bench, that a prejudice must come up. Then negating section 222 of CRPC, relying upon section 464 CRPC, that there is omission or there is an addition of a charge. The Supreme Court reconciled by three of the judgment said that the alternative charges can be framed subject to where the woman has died in a house. Therefore, a charge under section 302 in alternate charge for offense under section 304B can be formulated. Then the Supreme Court also came that offense, if one is tried for offense under section 304B, then 306 is a minor offense to section 304B, and then conviction can be a for offense under section 306 IPC also. Even one is tried for offense under section charge and tried for offense under section 304B IPC, he can be convicted for offense under section 306 IPC. These are the broad issues which came up regarding offense under 302, 304B and 306. At one time, Justice Cartwright gave a direction that once there is an offense under section 304B, the courts must formulate alternative charge of offense under section 302 IPC. A duty was cast upon the courts. Later, Justice Thakur in the three-judge bench watered down that judgment, overruled, saying that it is not necessary for the court to formulate alternative charge, but in the facts and circumstances of the court find, the courts can always formulate alternative charges. Now, having covered up to the charge, now we come up when by wife, offense of rape is made out. You must know that so far the marital rape is concerned, this is no longer on the statute book. Though in the various other countries, it is said that nobody can perform sexual intercourse with wife without her consent, and the concept of a marital rape has been introduced, it is not on the statute book, and even if somebody is complained, the police will not register a case. But close to this came, there is exception 2 to section 375, which says that a wife is more than 15 years of the age, if husband commit forcibly sexual intercourse, that will not be a criminal offense. The definition of section rape was changed, and 375, the exception 2 continued. Then came a judgment of the Supreme Court. They says that it is a discriminatory if a wife, if a woman less than 18 years can give a consent, we cannot make it compulsory, cannot take it on the account of a wife who is more than less than 18 years of age, but more than 15 years of age. Therefore, they had set aside that part and said that even in case of a wife, she must be above 18 years of age. Therefore, the judgment of the Supreme Court got Independent Thought versus Union of India, 2017, Volume 10, Supreme Court Cases, page 800. The section 375, exception 2 read that a sexual intercourse or a sexual act by man with his own wife, the wife being under 15 years of age, is not rape. Now this question was formulated that the exception carved out in the IPC creates an unnecessary and artificial distinction between a married girl child and an unmarried girl child, and has no clear nexus with any clear objective sought to be achieved. Therefore, exception 2 of section 375 was held to be violative of Article 14, 15, and 21 of the Constitution. And similarly, clause 6 of section 375, which says that it must be 18 years above, was read with, and similarly, section 198, subsection 6, which gives the right to the aggrieved party, was also held to be violative of the Constitution. Now we come to the offense under section 498A. Section 498A, 406, as you know, has flooded the courts and all cases have come up. There is said that there's a false implication of the husband. The implication is of the all members of the family of the husband. Even in the matrimonial relationship has failed. The institution of marriage is crumbling. It is failing because of introduction of section 498A of IPC. I must refer to the report of National Crime Record Bureau. In 2005, 58,390 cases were reported for offense under section 498A. 1,27,560 persons were arrested. 6,141 cases are found to be false. This number swelled in 2009 to 89,546 cases. 1,74,395 persons were arrested. It was found that 8,352 cases were false. In 2013, 466,079 cases are pending before the court, out of which only 7,258 cases resulted into conviction. 38,165 cases the court was drawn, and 8,218 cases are withdrawn. This number, swelling of numbers, so much cases disturb the Supreme Court and the lawmakers. Therefore, in the first time in Arnesh Kumar versus State of Bihar, the Supreme Court came referring to section 41 and 41A of the Code of Criminal Procedure, that before arrest of the husband is to be effected, investigating officers shall record reasons as to why arrest is necessary, and therefore before giving affecting arrest for his offenses under section if a conviction is less than sentenced to be what is less than 7 years, he must give a notice to the husband or his relations expressing his intention to effect the arrest. So this Rajesh Kumar judgment was broadened in another judgment, that is Rajesh Kumar Sharma, where Justice Goel, 2018, volume 10, SEC, page 472, said that a family welfare committee shall be constituted by every district judge before a case is registered, and effort will be made to reconcile the differences, and on basis of the report of the committee, family welfare committee, only the cases will be registered. This was challenged under Article 32, and the three-judge bench in a case of Social Action Forum for Manav Adhikar, 2018, volume 10, SEC, page 443, had set aside various directions given by two-judge bench in Rajesh Sharma and held that the court cannot legislate, the court cannot formulate family welfare committees. It is only three conditions upheld, that the notice will be given, reasons will be recorded as to why arrest is necessary, and recovery of Dowry articles is not a condition precedent for grant of bail, and the bail application shall be decided on the same day. Now, a lot of issues have arisen as Section 498 is concerned, where the jurisdiction to register the case will vest in the police. Now, this is no longer a sintagma. In Rupali Devi, a three-judge bench of the Supreme Court on a reference held that if the wife is also staying at the parent's house and even no physical act had occurred at that place, since the wife left the place where the offense under Section 498 had occurred, she was carrying mental agony by silence. Therefore, the definition of 498A, which says willful conduct amounting to cruelty, physical and mental, that mental part will continue. Even the wife resides at the parents' house, so nothing has occurred because the mental agony, mental cruelty is continuing. That place also will have a jurisdiction to try the offense. This judgment given by the Supreme Court on the jurisdiction is Rupali Devi versus State of Uttar Pradesh, 2019, volume 5, SEC, page 384. So far, jurisdiction regarding 406 offenses concerned, we have section 181, subsection 4. It says that husband who is having entrustment over the property, istidhan, must account for the property at the place where the wife is residing. Therefore, even wife, after leaving the matrimonial home, is residing at the place where the parents are residing. For offense under section 406 IPC, that case will also have a jurisdiction and the police can register a case there. So therefore, the jurisdiction issue, which engaged the courts on number of times, 482 petition was filed, no longer exists, nor the wife at the house of the parent house, even nothing is occurred. For offense under section 498A or 406 IPC, case can be registered. Now, various issues came up regarding offense under section 498A. Now, the definition of the cruelty has been broadened by bringing into protection of women from Domestic Violence Act. There, the financial, if is withdrawn, emotional support is not given, emotional harassment, emotional cruelty, that definition has been broadened. And recently, the Supreme Court said that they both must be read in tandem and in harmony. Therefore, Supreme Court, in a case of recently in the three-judge bench, said they will give a judicial verdict to enhance the objective of the legislature. Therefore, it must be read together. Now, in Punjab and in other places, one is confronted with NRI marriages. Marriages where a NRI will come, will affect a marriage, will stay with the house of in-laws, consummate marriage for 3-4 months and then go abroad and will desert the wife. Now this is confronting if the how to affect service upon the husband who has left the country. Though by the court giving various directions, I've given to the Ministry of External Affairs, there's a desk created in the Home Ministry, a joint secretary is there, that are subject to certain documents given, the service will be effective, but it has not yet a teeth, even the passport is impounded, even if the property of husband is resided, nothing meaningful has been done to bring husband to the law book or before the court of law. These are the broad issues regarding offenses of marriage. I have touched. Now I will invite the questions. So there are a lot of questions. I will request Shri Vikas Chatra to put the questions so that I'm able to answer them. One question.
I will read the questions for your convenience so that we can have a concentrated look towards this. So Deputy Chaudhary, is there any judgment by the Supreme Court that in case of Section 406, there is no need of reinvestigation of the bills and proofs by the IO who did not file the bills, etc. at the time of charge sheet?
See, these, even the bills have not filed. You can, party can always take recourse to Section 311 CRPC. Can file an application to 311 before the magistrate saying that matter be referred for further investigation, the IO to verify the bills and then make it part of it. Even if IO will not make it, application will file under Section 311 at any stage for bringing those bills on the care, on the file of the case. So application can be made to the magistrate at the time of filing of the charge sheet or before that, that investigating officer be directed to take bills into consideration. This direction can be also obtained under Section 482. If charge sheet has been filed, an application can be given, that a direction can be given to, may be given to the IO to further investigate and make bills part of the investigation. And even if the IO has not done, the case charges have been framed, then also application can be filed under Section 311 CRPC at any stage of the proceeding, saying that these bills be taken into consideration. And a witness can be examined by the wife, say a jeweler from whom the jewelry was purchased, say from the way the expenses of marriage was incurred, he can be brought as a witness, as a court witness, and taking recourse to Section 311. In appeal, one can take recourse to Section 394 for additional evidence. Next question, please.
Bhavna Khemani, if the husband is alcoholic and the wife refuses sexual relation, is the husband justified if he is emotionally torturing his wife?
See, this will depend upon the evidence of a very each case. If a husband is alcoholic, comes to the house, abuse the wife, give a beating to the wife, if his actions fall within the definition of cruelty, which is mental and physical, then as alcoholic, as a virtue, if he snatch the money, he give a beating to the wife, will constitute offense of cruelty. But a wife has a right to refuse the sexual intercourse. It is her privilege, her right. And if she refuses, husband can say it amounts to cruelty and seek a divorce. Under the definition, under the case of celebrated case of Dastoor versus Dastoor, the denial of sexual relations, consummation of marriage amounts to cruelty. So for Hindu law is concerned, it can be good ground for a divorce. But it cannot be a ground of for a husband to inflict cruelty. He cannot say the wife to yield or compel her for a sexual intercourse by physically or mentally. Say he is cutting a scathing remarks. He is telling a woman something, you are a frigid, you are useless, you are bunch, so and so. Then these words will constitute a mental cruelty within the definition of Section 498. No straitjacket formula can be laid. It depends upon the facts and circumstances, evidence of each case. Next question, please.
Thank you. Meanwhile, certain persons had posted their questions before 5:30. Somehow there was a link missing. They can repost their questions. Yes. Sandeep Parmavati, he takes a cue from two persons, RV and Gaurav. He says, I agree with them. And the question is same, he says. As such, genuine cases are being burdened on the judiciary, that many cases of perjury are taking toll in the courts. Why allow motivated litigation into the courts, wherein you find that the wife has done without any actually substantiated in any manner?
See, there is a bar under Section 195 CRPC and Section 340 CRPC, that if a house is a woman commits a perjury or a offense, if false cases are lodged, nobody can prosecute on the prosecution, only vest in the public servant. For the certain offenses, the definition is given in Section 195. Public servant or by the court in relation to which offense is committed. It is for the court that it is expedient in the interest of justice to launch the perjury proceedings. It is said that in our courts, number of persons take recourse to the falsehood. Each and every case cannot be prosecuted. We are already burdened with areas of cases. Our docket is flowing. If we start prosecuting, then main cases will not be decided. Court will be only saddled with the cases of a perjury. And in every case, a litigant has a belief that other party is not telling a lie. If this inquiry starts, we will not be able to justify our cases. Therefore, the legislation in wisdom has created a bar under Section 195 in an application file. In a given case where it is expedient in the interest of justice to do so, the court will take recourse to Section 340 and shall inquire a matter. After inquiring the matter, the court shall file a complaint of offense of perjury, or a public servant can file a complaint saying that offense is made out, say offense under Section 211, 218 IPC. These are offenses basically against the administration of justice. There is a separate chapter of these offenses, and therefore a right has not been given to a litigant to initiate proceedings of the perjury. He can only pray to the court that whether falsehood is palpably, where is a so falsehood that the conscience of the court is shaken, the court will take recourse to prosecute a person who has committed offense in administration of justice by the courts. Therefore, for a valid reasons, this right has not been given to every litigant to initiate the proceedings of the perjury. This remains with the public servant or with the court so far as offense of perjury is concerned.
CSG, in almost all matrimonial disputes cases, interim maintenance is awarded at the first instance without examining the merits or not is disputable. The real merits of the cases, that is HMA, DV, 498, are heard in the last. Why not direct merits of the cases with evidence and after that the judgment of maintenance?
All right. Since our topic is regarding the offenses, not of the maintenance, but since the question has come, the entire maintenance is awarded with the only condition that a wife should not go to the arms. She should not go for a begging. As per her status, she should survive during the course of the litigation. As in the Hindu Marriage Act under Section 23-24, interim maintenance awarded under the protection of women is concerned, even 125 CRPC, interim maintenance is granted. It is for give a sustenance to wife to have a litigation. In case of Asaram, while as a judge of Bappu Asaram, while as a judge of Rajasthan High Court at Jodhpur, I awarded interim maintenance to the victim amounting to rupees 3 lakhs so that she can sustain litigation. One of the conditions was that Appu Asaram is having a battery of lawyers, whereas she is not able. She has to survive. You can have a system for the protection of a witness protection program, so that she can withstand if she needs a financial help can be given. Even though the interim maintenance can be given to the victim of a rape, that is there, it is for sustenance and survival during the course of a litigation.
Abhinav Sharma, don't you think, sir, that there is a mindset and limited response of courts towards the plights faced by the husband in such cases? Even if a false case is found, the courts are least inclined to take action against the false accusation, much less the action under Section 211.
It's a debate, ongoing debate. I have already referred to the case of Anish Kumar, to the case of Rajesh Sharma, and then the recent case of Manav Adhikar by the Supreme Court. The courts are conscious that in number of cases, husband, if it not husband, relation of the husband, say a bua of the husband who married 30 years ago, a tai of a husband, or elder brother of the father of the husband, who has retired of his 80 years. He's brought into litigation. Number of relations are brought. Therefore, the courts have held that there is a misuse of Section 498A. But misuse itself is not sufficient to come to a conclusion that women are not being harassed. So, therefore, the section will remain. It has to be, courts have to be hyperactive to avoid plight of the relations of the harassment of the relations of the husband. No, I missed it. Who are the relations who can be prosecuted? In a one case, brother of a bhabhi of the husband was brought and accused. Then as a lawyer taking recourse to the analogy of section 198B, I said it can only be relation, definition of relation will include by blood, by marriage or by adoption. Therefore, brother of a bhabhi of the husband is neither a relation, will not come within an ambit of definition of relation. So for blood, marriage and adoption is concerned. Therefore, I succeed in 482, Justice Garewal quashed the proceeding. Therefore, the court has to be active. Courts are conscious of it. Therefore, in a case of Arnesh Kumar Kosar, 498A, arrest should not be effective. IU has to record reasons as to why arrest is necessary. And then the courts further came to conclusion that give a notice in 498A of 7 days at least, so that husband and the relations can obtain anticipated bail. Then in Rajesh Sharma, that it is, though the Family Welfare Committee was formulated, a preliminary inquiry was said. I may say that a 5-judge bench of the Supreme Court, Constitution Bench, Lalita Kumari, being conscious, said if a matrimonial offence is to be listed, a preliminary inquiry must be conducted by the investigating officer. So the system is in place, courts are overactive. Under Jay Sharma, it was held that recovery of a dowry articles is not a condition present for grant of bail. This direction given by the Supreme Court Rajesh Sharma has been upheld by 3-judge bench in a Manavadhikar case. Therefore, the courts are conscious, courts are active, they are taking it, but there is a harassment of a husband in few cases. It will not mean that the offense of cruelty to the wife will not exist on the statute book.
The person is anonymous, but he writes with the showing us why, so I can understand. And he says that I'm an NRI. My wife filed a case under 498A 307. Please guide how to handle such a situation once I am innocent.
Well, consultations can't be given in this session. He must consult his lawyer.
Right.
See, this will be one has to be very cautious.
Yes. Abhinav Sharma. Sir, there is a mindset and a limited response of courts towards the plight faced by the husband in such cases. Even if false. No, that has been right. Because he's repeated that question.
Abhinav, I agree with you. I must say that Abhinav has been a decent advocate general. He's a very leading advocate of Rajasthan. And he has a flair. He writes very well. He's the most eloquent counsel. It is true that there is a plight of husband. It is true. But one must understand, it's the intent of the legislature. Till 1983, in the entire Indian Penal Code, no accused was named. After this, on 25th December 1983, offense under Section 498 came. For the first time in IPC, the accused was named, that is husband and his relations. Earlier it was whoever so commits the offense. This legislature brought it. It's a, when the courts had tried to legislate, it said it's not a function of a legislature. The time is coming, the thinking is coming. It is true that in every family we have introduced police in our social value. The family used to resolve by their own mediation, by their own panchayat, the family disputes, the only panchayat. They have a brotherhood when the matrimonial disputes are resolved. They are no longer, the world has grown, time has grown. Once the statute book brought 498A, 406, Supreme Court brought an offense, then all false cases are coming. Till 1983 to 2005, husband was a dirty word for the court. Everything, the court will grant bail to the all relations, but will not to the husband. Husband will go for a one day, will be bail granted. But times are changing, we are evolving. we, the course, want to save the institution of marriage. The response, of course, is also changing, as is evident in the case of Anish Kumar, Rajesh Sharma, and Manavikar. The courts have evolved the law. We are in the process of evolving, and we will evolve for the good times. And the husband will also come at par with their wife, and his plight can also be understood. But it is true that a woman has a special. So far, entire our legal system is concerned, this has a special category. We have a special category for old infirm. If we go to the proviso of section 437, which is bail, it is said women, the court will be extra indulgent to grant bail. Woman is considered a weakling, abla, and this is something the courts have a different perspective for a woman, for a weaker section. When I became a judge, a senior judge told me that a judge must be biased. Biased for whom? He said biased for a woman, biased for oppressed, for a Dalit, who are voiceless, who have nothing. The judge must be extra compassionate about them. These are the ingrained in our system. Next question, please.
We have unmuted Abhinav because Abhinav was posting few questions. And once you have said that, I said that let him be directly ask a question. He may not feel has our question. As he has question.
No, Abhinav is very dear to me. Is a very dear to me. Now I can say admitted. I never admitted. He used to appear before me, and for his eloquence, I always had a soft corner. This after retirement, this I can admit.
That's your lordship's greatness, my lord. And I have always appreciated the way your lordship has been treating us, and has always been a teacher to us in the bar while your lordship was in bench here. My lord, I had a specific question, one, with regard to this NRI marriages. This is an important aspect which I want to touch, because there are offenses which are filed, and a case is filed over here. And say, for example, a boy is residing out of country. Can there be a provision in the, I have seen one such case in my entire career as 15 years as a lawyer now. There can be an anti-suit injunction against a dowry, proceedings which are going in abroad countries, say for example, America. And can those anti-suit injunctions which are granted by courts, usually in India, would be resulting into some good fruitful results? Say for example, there is a decree of divorce in America, and then an anti-suit injunction is filed over here in this country, and there is a decree granted for anti-suit injunction. Whether that decree will still be valid for Indian legal context in that particular manner, or what would be the situation in that cases?
See, this is this NRI marriages. Of Harmanpreet Singh Ahluwalia, Justice Sinha speaking for the said NRI marriages, that if a major large part of the transaction is abroad, the court under 482 can quash the proceedings. Then dispute arose in many cases regarding the custody of the child. The question came that in a divorce petition, the custody of the child is determined by the courts abroad, say American UK has given a decree as to how the custody of the child is to be decided. The courts saying Article 226 or writ of habeas corpus said, parentis praetus jurisdiction vests in the court. That decree can be taken into consideration as a possessive value. The paramount welfare of the child will be consideration for the court, because court have a parental jurisdiction and the court will give directions which is better for the child. Say the courts came to conclusion that if a girl child is less than 5 years and is a girl child, even if it is said that the custody will remain with the husband, the courts are nothing doing. Since we have a parental jurisdiction, we will not accept this and say that the custody of the girl child less than 5 years will remain with the mother. So if the child is breastfed by the mother, the courts have said. But if the child is 14 years, 15 years, a male child is taking an education abroad, and if the custody has been given to the father, the courts have been relied upon the judgment. So we take the judgment as a possessive value. So for divorce, say for a istri dhan, for the properties to be divided, all conditions have been settled, agreed between the parties, that is a good ground taken by the court to quash the proceedings, as in Harmanpreet Singh Ahluwalia's case.
We are unmuting Jaapna Dillo. She wants a question to be posed. Meanwhile, Ananda Nimka, Jaapna has been unmuted. Yes, Jaapna.
Hi, sir. Sir, I want to know that 3 years ago I was evicted from my matrimonial home, and I want to know what to do regarding my passport, in the sense that does it fall under a criminal breach of trust, or does it have to, do I have to refresh it, getting a new passport? And of course, my husband needs to, I mean, what does the passport fall under, and how should I proceed with that regarding?
Don't formulate questions. I can be quoted that.
Sorry?
Don't formulate personal questions. Don't ask personal questions. It is said that it's a very bad, it is said that Justice Ahluwalia said it in the court of law, don't it? You can put the question in a general form.
Okay, generally, sir, generally, if one's passport is also part of the properties that have been kept by the in-laws, then how does one proceed with the complaint? Does it have to go under a separate section?
You're accused in some proceedings. If one is accused in some proceedings, the Supreme Court has said the passport need not be kept, and you can take a permission from the court for release of the passport, and after getting the passport released, with saying that you will return the passport after you undertake a journey, you can take permission from the court to go abroad.
No, but if they say that they've destroyed it, shouldn't the people who've kept anybody's passport be held liable or be punished for the fact that
this is very personal passport?
Would it not become very difficult for a wife?
Always be issued. You can go to the passport officer, get the passport issued if it is destroyed. These are the specific problems of an individual. So this should not be made part of the webinar.
Thank you, sir.
Sandeep Paramathy has posted lots of questions, and now he has also raised the hand. We are unmuting him because at least he will have a composite question to be asked. Yes, Sandeep has been unmuted. Sandeep?
Hello?
Yeah.
So good evening, sir. This is Sandeep Amrati. I'm from Andhra Pradesh. Sir, my questions are around the Dowry Prohibition Act, which was enacted in 1961. So the first question I have is around Section 3 of Dowry Prohibition Act. It says punish or prosecute both parties which are giving and taking dowry. But if you look at the NCRB data, we do not find anybody who is prosecuted for the offense of giving dowry. Only dowry takers are prosecuted and punished.
Dowry is an offense. It is true that prosecution should be launched. There is a dowry prohibition officer. You can approach him. You can launch the proceedings. But please understand that giving of a dowry, if the case is, somebody has to file a case.
Okay, sir. Why does police not book the parties, other parties also in the same case? Because a complainant is giving a complaint that her father or relative is giving the dowry and her husband or husband family is taking the dowry. So when the complainant is giving two parties' names, why police book only one party and let go the other party? That is my question, sir.
It is true. It is not happening. We must see that in the context, 1986, amendment came. If a woman commit abetment of suicide or of a 304B, earlier the property used to go to the husband, because under the Succession Act, the husband is entitled to the property. Legislation amended it, said that a woman has died because of offense in Section 304B or 306, then the property, her istri dhan, will go to her parents. It is true that Section 3 of the Dowry Prohibition Act say that offense will be if anybody you give a jury is an offense, no prosecutions are coming. Nobody has initiated, police should initiate. It is not coming. At least the jury prediction officer should initiate the proceedings. Though it is said there is another Dory Prevention Act rules are there, the list of the Dory articles given is to be prepared. List is never prepared. A kind of allegations level that I was compelled to give a, these kind of a Dory or the Dory was demanded. But then the courts also visited an idea that for a successful marriage, the father is compelled to part with the Dory articles. Therefore, a kind of a this system that Dory should be prohibited for a Dory Prevention Act, no complaints are coming. It is true.
Thank you.
So, Sapandhir, who has been the vice president of the bar, plus he's a trained mediator, he wants to put a question directly because he's obviously, since he's a mediator, he wants that certain flip towards the mediation should also be given in such like cases so that the differences are eased out. Over to you, Sapan.
Sir, good evening, ji. In fact, sir, my take is that that before lodging any FIR, the police people should send all the complaints once to the mediation center, because in mediation it's very helpful for all these matrimonial matters. Mainly, as my lord has said, that it is main problem is with the parties are the ego problem amongst.
I'm not said ego. That is Adler said it. He said, Jung said it is a maladjustment. One said it's ego. One is said it's a sexual preferences.
That's
these
right.
Are the philosophical moorings. What is it? We don't know. But this direction was given in the Rajesh Sharma's case by the Supreme Court, saying that a family welfare committee is being constituted. Before cases are registered, the family welfare committee report should be taken whether a case should be registered or not. The role of mediator is to be played by the Family Welfare Committee, which was to be constituted by District Judge, who is the president of a legal service authority. But this has been set aside by the 3-judge bench, saying, overruling it, saying that the courts cannot legislate. It is for legislature to introduce the committee. But Supreme Court in a Lalita Kamari's case, the Constitution Bench has said that before a case of matrimonial offense is registered, a preliminary inquiry ought to be held.
Yes, that's there. Thank you, sir.
We have unmuted Indu. Indu has posed a question. Indu, you can pose the question directly. Indu Prashad.
Yeah, hello, sir.
Yes, please. Yes. Go
yeah,
sir,
my question is, sir, is bearing from cohabitation by husband on mere doubt of having extramarital affair will come under mental cruelty?
Pardon, please, what is the question?
My question is bearing a wife from cohabitation on mere doubt of having an extramarital affair will come under cruelty, mental cruelty?
If wife alleges that husband is having extramarital relations, or husband is alleging wife is having extramarital relations?
Husband is alleged,
alleging
on wife that
wife, then she can take a plea in the Hindu Marriage Act for a dissolution of the marriage, saying that a wife was having extramarital relations. But let's know that before Section 497 was set aside by the Supreme Court of Adultery, even wife who was having extramarital relations could not be prosecuted. So far offense, wife is concerned, no offense exists as far as the statute book is concerned for prosecution of the wife. It is only a ground which is available before a family court for annulment of the marriage.
So my question is, bearing from cohabitation will come under mental cruelty or not?
It is. You have to go to Dastane versus Dastane. They say that if wife refuses, it is in a not a, so far criminal offense is concerned, it is in a family court so far a matrimonial relations annulment or divorce is concerned. So nothing criminal about it.
All right, thank you.
So Vikashi, we are already up, or how many questions
yes,
you have?
So the questions are invariably, I will seeing, and somebody said that it's not a consultation room. Primarily, I'm seeing that large number of questions are invariably boiling down from their either the client or the personal suffering. Because one thing which I would be happy to share, today was one of the sessions where we had also the public at large participating in the on the webinar. Otherwise, invariably, it is the students, professors, lawyers, etc. One last question I will ask Sumati. She will be unmute her. We are unmuting her. So Sumati has a question. She's a practicing lawyer out here only. And another fascinating fact today, sir, you would have seen that though all webinars we are holding, we have pan-India presence, and the people who are asking questions are also not restricted to Punjab Haryana High Court, but there are large number of participants who are participating from different areas. Yes, Sumati, you can ask the question. We are unmuting you.
Yes, Dr. Saab.
Thanks, sir. So we are very thankful that you have spared your valuable time for enriching us on such an important topic. So my question is that considering the dynamism which the legislature as well as the judiciary has shown while interpreting these family laws, so shouldn't the provisions which have been dealt under section 493 and 496 be also made gender neutral? As in, not only a man, even the woman should be held liable for inducing a man to cohabit with him and then have sexual intercourse with him. Why only a man?
So you are asking in relation to offense under section 496?
493 and 496.
So far 493 is concerned, it is man by deceit or by a fraudulent go for a sexual intercourse with a woman. This is akin to the offense of a rape. Therefore, it is not woman will induce, it will not come. All right.
Probably Vibha Diman is there. We'll see whether she was there. She wanted.
Who's asking?
Vibha Diman, I'm seeing whether she's there or not. Because she's quite enthusiastic on this. And then if there's Mundali Deshmukh, probably from Maharashtra, I can ask if she can, if she wants to pitch in something. I will unmute her. It's her choice.
So we take it as the last question?
Yes. Vibha, we've unmuted. She's from our High Court. She's a vibrant lawyer.
All right.
So the way she will pose the question, you will come to know that she's very vibrant.
All right. No. It was a very informative session. No questions. In fact, I wanted to make a request. Let's call him once again.
Oh, thank you. So nice of you.
Well, also, informative. Let's have him once again because it is very helpful for a mediation also.
So kind of you, ma'am. Thank you.
Sir, ye, wo yaad aa raha hai ki ye dil mange more.
Yes.
Thank you. So nice of you. But thanks to everybody for a patient hearing to a judge. We go off the air. Have a good day and good times ahead.
So let me the formal. So we are all obliged that the insights given to you, given by your good self, you have issued the topic at the first brush when we had asked you and invited you to come on the topic. On the first brush when the invite was prepared, it looked as if it's, we will just have one flip. Then they say, whenever there is anything, one can have a 1D view, 2D view, 3D view. But as we know, all we see 5D movies, 7D movies. The same way, I was just jotting down what topics you have covered in a short time. I saw that you have covered bigamy, adultery, gifts, suicide, alienations, and all such issues which were covered. It is only a person with an immense knowledge can cover these issues, and especially who has got good professional practice before being elevated to the judge. And a person who has such immense knowledge sharing on a platform is always encouraging to the participants, because the cobwebs which are in the mind of anyone can only be dispelled either by lot and lot of reading. But in a capsule form, as my father used to say, the capsule is very small, but if you have a pain in the body, it can remove the entire pain. In the same form, if a person with an great acumen, legal acumen and knowledge gives a capsule lecture, it acts like anything and the entire body is rejuvenated. It's just like a multivitamin
and antidotes given by you are much encouraging to us. Ye dil kehta hai ki rukte jao aur sunte hum sunte jaye, but we all know the time is the essence, and we can only request that on this platform we meet again, though undoubtedly we meet time and again, but it's a common platform where pan India people and sometimes even people from abroad, like I was seeing questions people asking NRIs, etc. It shows that people are taking keen interest, and we are live on the Facebook. People have just latched up. They thought a judge who has got the knowledge of Punjab Haryana High Court, Calcutta High Court, as well as Rajasthan High Court. Nothing better could have been given. So before going, after quite large number of days, we are just asking 2-3 tips from your side for a lawyer still. So what is your take that what a young lawyer should do? One, like I know you personally, that you had a lot of struggle, but the grit, the wit, and the knowledge made a mark. What is your take how the young lawyer should make this thing? Because there's a lot of struggle. They say this, you are always lonely on the top, but at the bottom there's too much. So you have to create your own niche. How to do that?
Say, Vikas ji, this is very topic, very dear to me. It requires one separate session now. How to young lawyers should struggle, make mark, how they should come up in a profession, what is required. Since I came from a first generation, I started coming to the courts on a cycle. The God has been kind. I was fortunate to come up in the profession in my own humble way. But compared to Punjab and Haryana, compared to Calcutta, I find that members of the bar, junior counsel, the Rajasthan, they require more into it. If anybody is hearing, I will request Rajasthan Bar Association to have an exclusive session for the young lawyers, and how the young lawyers should come up. It should be in a very private. It should not be recorded, because what you can say to the young lawyers who to come in the profession can't be said in the public platform. This is something, you know, it is a kind of hypocrisy. Says we say that hard work, we have been doing this, I've been doing, you got this. This is not. When you speak with the young lawyers, you speak with a holding no bars. It should be an interaction which should not be recorded, and it's a very dear to me. And I feel that my members of the bar at Rajasthan, young lawyers, are not fortunate as the lawyers in Punjab and Calcutta are. They require more intuitive moorings as to how to come up in the profession. I would love to do so, but it should be in private.
So,
speak all good things like this. This is not a profession. This is a profession, has its own limitations. You come from the family background, you come with something, how to make it mark. It's a different something where a lot of blunt speech is required.
Point well taken.
Holding no bars, I should address the junior counsels. Hope sometime Rajasthan Bar give me an opportunity to share my views.
So 2 points well taken from what you said, that you said the God was kind enough. But somewhere down the line, while as a student and in life, one always says that God helped those who helped themselves.
All right. So you are insisting I narrate one anecdote. Jinnah was asked, what is the secret of a success in a profession? He said, firstly luck, secondly luck, and finally luck. So you may say that you succeed in profession by luck, but what is luck? Luck is maximum opportunities. How the luck will, lady luck will smile upon you if you get maximum opportunities. Say if a batsman gets 100 innings to play, he has got 100 opportunities. Therefore, for a luck, you must get maximum opportunities. How you get maximum opportunities? You have maximum acquaintances. More acquaintances you have, more vibrant you are, you will get more opportunities, more luck to smile. This is something topic which requires no hold bar. I can, since I have come out of the own poverty, own my struggle, I want to share with the young lawyers. and I have a special affection corner with the young lawyers of Rajasthan. I want to share with them, given an opportunity, holding no bar, I will come out. But it should not be recorded.
So another thing, what you said, you want something to be taken in private. The large number of participants from Punjab, Haryana are also listening. We will definitely go with a session. Let this COVID, etc., where all that social distancing.
You know, lawyers of Punjab and Haryana High Court are privileged. They come from the affluent section of the society. They are having so many privileges when they step into bar, which is not there at other places. All right.
Thank you.
This is a private discussion. Let's say with a good note.
So only one point I will say, as you said, because I learned from you that a good lawyer is one who knows what to present before the judge and what not to present. Let there be one presentation where it is no bar.
No, will I say that
only bar and bar?
Criminal lawyer must know what not to speak, what not to say. The problem with the criminal lawyer is he speaks too much. A criminal lawyer in court must know what not to say, what not to speak. All right, let's sign out.
Right, sir. Thank you. It was a wonderful session. The insights given by you.
Have a good day and good times ahead.
Okay. And tomorrow we have a session by Mr. Puneet Bali and Yuvraj Singh, Sports Law and Beyond. Just be connected with us. Tomorrow it would be a fascinating session from a senior advocate giving his insights on sports law and to hear the other sides, the challenging, etc. How his career went. It will be a fantastic session. Just be connected. Let's see how the six sixes which he played in the match goes in the session tomorrow. Stay connected. Stay blessed. Thank you.